We'll be looking at chapter number 1 tonight. Let's look at verses 1 through 9. Verse number 1 of chapter 1 in the book of Esther. Now it came to pass in the days of Ahasuerus, this is Ahasuerus, which reigned from India even unto Ethiopia, over 127 provinces, that in those days when the king Ahasuerus sat on the throne of his kingdom, which was in Shushan the palace, in the third year of his reign he made a feast unto all his princes and his servants, the power of Persia and Media, the nobles and princes of the provinces being before him. When he showed the riches of his glorious kingdom and the honor of his excellent majesty, many days, even 84 days. And when these days were expired, the king made a feast unto all the people that were present in Shushan the palace, both unto great and small, 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace, where were white and green and blue hangings, fastened with the cords of fine linen, and purple to silver rings and pillars of marble. The beds were of gold and silver upon a pavement of red and blue and white and black marble. They gave them drink in vessels of gold, the vessels being diverse one from another, and royal wine in abundance, according to the state of the king. And the drinking was according to the law, none did compel, for so the king had appointed to all the officers of his house, that they should do according to every man's pleasure. Also Vashti, the queen, made a feast for the women in the royal house, which belonged to King Ahasuerus. Let's go ahead and pray. Dearly Father, we thank you so much for helping us today. Father, we ask you and we need your help to know your word better, to have a heart stirred, that even though looking at the things going about the world today, we know that you are in control. We know that you are working your plan in ways we cannot even possibly understand. We praise you for your goodness. We praise you for your greatness. And at the end, we will look back and say, wow, what a mighty God we serve. Father, we ask you to bless this message. Help me as I speak. Fill me with your spirit. And may each person tonight have open hearts to hear what you have them to hear. I do pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I've heard it before, and so I will say it now. Sometimes it seems like things in the world are falling apart, right? With the last year of COVID. Okay, let's just talk about that. The craziness of COVID. You know, I was thinking about this as I was pondering. I've now been the pastor of the church for a year now. And what a hard year it was. Like, right away, on March 1st, I became the pastor. If I had known what was going to transpire the next 2 weeks, I might have thought to myself, maybe this is not the best time to do this. But lo and behold, the Lord had other plans. And so the Lord called me to be the pastor. And then 2 weeks later, I closed the church. Okay. All right, Lord, I believe this is your will. All these things are telling me I need to close the church, and so I did. And so looking and thinking outside the box, okay, YouTube. I know nothing about YouTube. Let's go ahead and look into that. And then doing videos. I had no idea how to do a video or to edit a video or do anything with a video. So I had to learn for all this from scratch. So all this entire year, I kept on thinking to myself, why this year did I have to become the pastor? Why couldn't it have been last year, or the year before that, or the year before that, or the year after this one, you know, 2022. Well, why 2020? I used to kid, 2020 is, of course, the year I was looking forward to because we would have hindsight. 2020. And so, in all reality, though, it was not my plan to become the pastor and close the church. But God had other plans. It's amazing to see God at work, right? It's amazing to see what God does at instance of time that you would look back and say, wow, I really got close to God because of this circumstance or that. For instance, if you had a time where you were sick, a time where you thought, well, this might be the end, a time where you thought, well, it's all hopeless, but yet you grow closer and closer to the Lord. What a wonderful time that is, though the circumstances are not that great. In every single time that we could say, well, this was a terrible year, we can also say, well, God's been working amongst all the bad things that have happened this year. Perhaps it might be, you might say, well, our country's going to be ruined because the wrong people are in office. Some of you might agree with that statement. In all reality, God providentially picked our electors. God providentially picked certain people to be in power. God providentially picked certain bills to get passed or denied in the Congress. Think about it. God, though, is working. Never lose sight of the fact that God works, especially at times where it seems like everything's coming apart. I've heard it once said that if things look like they're coming apart, don't worry, it's actually coming together for God's perfect plan, God's perfect timing. And so here's the major thing that we're going to learn tonight in Esther chapter number 1. Esther chapter 1 was very challenging for me to study, and you'll see why. It was very challenging in that there is no place in this entire first chapter that God is mentioned, that the Jews are mentioned, that anything worth, like, anything about the Bible is actually mentioned. It's all about heathen people, pagans. So we're going to look at that. But here's what we're going to learn tonight. If you don't get anything else, this is what you should get away from this. God uses imperfect people with imperfect motives in imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential perfect plan. Okay, let me say that again. God uses imperfect people with imperfect motives in imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential perfect plan. And we're going to see this all really throughout the book of Esther. I named this series on the book of Esther, In God's Good Time. A great quote from Winston Churchill's speech in that of World War II, and we talked about that the last time we looked at the book of Esther. And so we're going to look at this chapter and see all the different things about it, but always we need to remind ourselves that God uses imperfect people and with imperfect motives and imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential perfect plan. All right, let's look at it. First of all, we're going to see, there's four parts to the passage. First, we're going to see the man of mystery. The man of mystery. And you'll see why in a second, why I named Ahasuerus the man of mystery. Notice with me in verse number 1. Now, it came to pass in the days of Ahasuerus, this is Ahasuerus, which reigned from India even unto Ethiopia over 127 provinces, that in those days when the king Ahasuerus sat on the throne of his kingdom, which was in Shushan the palace, in the third year of his reign, he made a feast unto all his princes and his servants, the power of Persia and Media, the nobles and princes of the provinces being before him. All right, stop right there. The question is that I had to deal with this week. who is King Ahasuerus? And you know my answer is? I still have no idea who the King Ahasuerus is. Okay, here's the thoughts behind it. Okay, so one person that I went to, Bishop Usher, very good. He did a chronology of the entirety from creation up to 70 AD. This is his masterpiece work, which was actually translated from Latin into English that I read. And so as I went through the passage, he said, Ahasuerus is none other than King Darius. Let me give you a for instance about who these kings are. All right, first king that we see on the throne of Persia and Media is that of Cyrus. He's called Cyrus the Great. He is a man that conquered everybody, and last but all, he conquered Babylon. And he did so in a particular way that only God could arrange the events of it. It was so amazing that he built up these dams and these dikes so that the water of the river going right through Babylon would cease. And his soldiers would then march on dry ground in the riverbed as they're going into the city underneath the big gates that were right there. And so they got into the city without any problem, and they took over the city in one night. That was Daniel chapter 5 talking about King Belshazzar. That is exactly what happened. And then Cyrus gave the Babylonian city over to his uncle, Darius the Mede. This Darius the Mede is not who Ahasuerus is. He's totally different. He's Ahasuerus the Mede. Darius the Mede is not Darius the Persian. Moving on. So we have Cyrus the Great. He's the great king. Then we get to his son, which Cambyses was not a great king whatsoever. He only reigned for 8 years, and eventually, I think he was deposed by one of his servants. Anyway, but then turmoil happened in that Cambyses did not have any kids. So somebody came to the throne under dubious circumstances. This is Darius the Great. Darius was not blood relative to Cyrus, but he married one of Cyrus's daughters. So now he is on the throne. And this, Bishop Usher says, is Ahasuerus. Okay, moving on to somebody else's commentary. Oh, he is none other than Xerxes. Okay, who's Xerxes? Well, Darius had a son. His name was Xerxes. Xerxes' name was so amazing. It's called the meaning of Xerxes is he's the hero of heroes. What a name, right? What a name for a person, Xerxes the Great. And so I really hope that Ahasuerus is not Xerxes, because Xerxes was a terrible person. Just reading through the different things that he did, I thought, oh boy, I hope Ahasuerus is not you and Esther married you. No, I hope not. And then on top of that, the queen that's supposed to be Vashti did some horrible things too. I'm like, oh, wow, this is terrible. These are all pagans, right? Okay, another person says, no, Ahasuerus is none other than Artaxerxes the Great. Everybody's the great here. So we have Cyrus the Great, we have Darius the Great, we have Xerxes the Great, we have Artaxerxes the Great. Okay, Artaxerxes the First, who is the Artaxerxes in Ezra and Nehemiah, so it ties in with that, he might be the Ahasuerus himself. But then you go to the other people. You go to the Greek translation of the Bible, the Septuagint, which is non-inspired and all that. I don't want to get into detail. They put a lot of interpretation into the passages, which I disagree with how they interpreted some things. And so Ahasuerus, they transliterated into Artaxerxes. And then what they said was, it's not Artaxerxes the First, but rather Artaxerxes the Second. So Artaxerxes had a son. His name was Darius. Darius the Second. And then he had a son, Artaxerxes the Second. He had a son, Artaxerxes the Third. We're not talking about the Third. So who is Ahasuerus? No idea. I have no idea who this person is. I would love to figure this out. And I spent a lot of time this week looking and searching and understanding and thinking and trying to consider, well, who is Ahasuerus? I think I could write a good doctrinal dissertation for a PhD on who the identity of Ahasuerus and Vashti. But I have said enough about them. Man of mystery, what you need to know that if it was any single one of these people, they're pagan. They are all about themselves. They are all conquering kings. Well, sort of. Cyrus conquered. Darius went after Greece, failed. Xerxes, he went after Greece, he failed. Artaxerxes, he went after Greece, and he failed. Darius went after Greece, and he failed. Artaxerxes II, he went after Greece, and failed. A lot of failure here in the Persian Empire against Greece. We know providentially God was strengthening Greece so that Alexander the Great would be the conquering king over everybody else for Persia, and taking over from Persia as the number one kingdom of the world. And so we see that, okay, Ahasuerus, man of mystery, he is not a godly king. He is not a Jewish king. He is not what we would call a Christian person. He's not a Christian politician. He is a heathen and acts just like a heathen. But remember, God uses imperfect people with imperfect motives in imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential, perfect plan. Moving on, second one is the Feast of Fortune. Feast of Fortune. Notice with me in verse number 4. When he showed the riches of his glorious kingdom and the honor of his excellent majesty many days, even 180 days. When these days were expired, the king made a feast unto all the people that were present in Shushan the palace, both unto great and small, even 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace, where were white, green, blue hangings, fastened with cords of fine linen and purple to silver rings and pillars of marble. The beds were of gold and silver. How do you want to sleep on that bed? Gold and silver upon a pavement of red and blue and white and black and marble. They gave them drink in vessels of gold, the vessels being diverse one from another, and royal wine in abundance according to the state of the king. And that drinking was according to the law, none did compel, for so the king had appointed to all the officers of his house that they should do according to every man's pleasure. Also Vashti, the queen, made a feast for the women in the royal house which belonged to King Ahasuerus. So here's what happened. Something happened in the third year of King Ahasuerus that made him party. For whatever reason it might be. Now, if it is certain people, I know what happened, but I have no idea if it is really what was this about. So, in all reality, what it could be is that either A, the king became the king in the third year of his reign, which makes no sense, except for there was a question mark as to who will be the next king. He was crowned king and came to the throne, but another person came and said, no, I should be king. And they had a little powwow, and eventually that guy that is on the throne is the ruler. Okay, that's the third year. Or it could be a successful campaign against Egypt. Could be. Could be any of these different things. The thing about it is that the king wanted to have a feast. And the reason for the feast is to show off the riches of his great majesty. Now, it could be Artaxerxes and that he was the richest of the Persian kings. Could have been him. Could have been somebody after him. Very rich guy. But here's the thing about it. The pride of this King Ahasuerus, whoever he is immense. Think about having a party at your house for a week. Instead of VBS, we're going to have a party at the Boots house for an entire week, and all the church is invited to come. That's not what's going to happen. But, you know, just showing forth our new house and all that and all of our stuff. Well, why would you want to see all of our stuff? Anyway, but this guy was rich. You saw that with all the different things, all the different fine linens and the gold beds and the silver beds and the silver rings and all this. He's just showing off how great he is. What a prideful man. 180 days for this feast. That's half a year. Think about the magnitude of that. It would be like saying, right now, I'm going to have a party from right now all the way to, wait, it's May, so November? October. Well, tell me what it is. Okay, so half a year from right now, 5, 11, okay, that would be November. How in the world? What a prideful person. Now, true enough, you say, well, this can't be real. Some of the people that I've read this week say, well, Esther's just a fictitious story. I'm like, no, it's the word of God. So it's absolutely true. And on top of that, there's other Eastern custom that says, yes, this happens. Like in China, they had a feast of 120 days. In other places, it was 150 days. So this is actually common. The Feast of Fortune. Ahasuerus wants to show off how great he is. Prideful man that he is. Remember, though, God uses imperfect people with imperfect motives in imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential perfect plan. Even though this is the ruler, even this is the king of the world right now, God is still working in the details. Now, number three. We'll see the damsel of decency. The damsel of decency. Notice with me in verse number 10. On the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, he commanded Mehuman, Mizphah, Harbona, Bigtha, and Abagatha, Zephar, and Carcass, the seven chamberlains that served in the presence of Ahasuerus the king. I did better with that without practicing than I did Wednesday night when I was trying to read those kings' names in Genesis chapter 14. Oh, anyway, moving on. To bring Vashti, the queen, before the king with the royal crown to show the people and the princes her beauty, for she was fair to look on. But the queen Vashti refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned in him. So we have this Vashti. We have no idea who she is. In all reality, the people that I've looked up for these different kings, she's not a good person. She is not a good person whatsoever. Things that these women did and got away with is horrendous. You think, I'm not going to name the name. You think one of the prominent politician women of our land that got away with a lot of things, all these are worse, much worse. Any one of these could be Vashti, okay? And so here's the thing about it. She, though, is a damsel of decency. Right now, Ahasuerus is merry with wine. Whether it means he's actually intoxicated, it's up for debate. It could be that he just wants to show off his prized wife. And so, because she is beautiful, he summons her to show forth her beauty. Well, Vashti does not want to come. And there's a lot of different reasons why that is a possibility. A lot of them has to point to the fact that, well, in the times of feasts and all this, only the ones that would be at the king's side would be those that are the lowest of the low wives that the king would have. So there's a bit of a pride issue for her. It's possibly the indecency of what he wanted her to wear. There's possibilities of that, or not wear, in fact. But in all reality, she says, no. No, I'm not doing it. I think it has more to the effect, because the Word of God is very interesting. Little things here and there, I think, has a lot to say about it. Notice with me in verse number 8. And the drinking was according to the law. Notice this. None did compel. No one in the kingdom was compelled to come. Drink as much as you want, or as least as you want. You're not forced to do that. But what Vashti? He orders her like a servant to come before him. I'm not doing that. She's having a banquet for the women, because the women and the men, they have to be separate in that custom, unless you're the lowest of the low women with the king. So Vashti, for some reason, does not want to come before the king, and the king commands her to do that. She is not a saint in any description of what a saint is, but yet God uses imperfect people with imperfect motives and imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential perfect plan. Next is the decision for destiny. The decision for destiny. Notice with me in verse number 13 now. Something here will happen that will set in motion everything about the book of Esther. And notice with me what happens. Verse 13, then the king said to the wise men, which knew the times, for so was the king's manner toward all that knew law and judgment, and the next unto him was Karshina, Shethar, Admatha, Tarshish, Meres, Mersenna, and Memucan, the seven princes of Persia and Media, which saw the king's face, and which sat the first in the kingdom. What shall we do unto Queen Vashti according to law, because she hath not performed the commandment of the king Ahasuerus by the chamberlains? Okay, big problem. The king is numero uno in the land. He is number one. And the queen said no. The command of the king is given. And his number one wife says, I will not obey the king. For whatever reason, I will not obey the king. Ooh. Here's what happens. Okay, so what should we do to Queen Vashti? Verse number 16, and Memucan answered before the king and the princes, Vashti the queen hath not done wrong to the king only, but also to all the princes and to all the people that are in all the provinces of the king Ahasuerus. For this deed of the queen shall come abroad unto all women, so that they shall despise their husbands in their eyes when it shall be reported. The king Ahasuerus commanded Vashti, the queen, to be brought in before him, but she came not. Likewise shall the ladies of Persia and Media say this day unto all the king's princes which have heard of the deed of the queen. Thus shall there arise too much contempt and wrath. Okay, what this prince said, you let her get away with this? All the ladies of the land will despise their husbands and rebel. Oh my. We gotta keep power ourselves. Okay. Now, sure enough, the biblical understanding of the house relationship, man was created first, women after man. Man's the head. Women should be subjected to the man. Yes, that is the biblical plan for the house. You can't argue with it. You have to go to Ephesians. You have to go all these places. And this is what God says for the household. The husband be the head of the wife. The wife be submissive to the wife. And that is a healthy relationship. No matter what the world tells us what a healthy relationship is like. Okay. So here's what happens. They, though, hurt in their pride, saying, oh, if you let this go, king, the women, our wives, will rebel against us. And everybody else, well, to the lowest, they're going to rebel against us. So you need to make her a public example, is what he's going to get at. All right, look with me at verse number 19. If it please the king, let there go a royal commandment from him, and let there be written among the laws of the Persians and the Medes, that it be not altered, that Vashti come no more before King Ahasuerus, and let the king give her royal estate unto another that is better than she. And when the king's decree, which he shall make, shall be published throughout all his empire, for it is great, All the wives shall give to their husbands honor, both to great and small, and the same pleased the king and princes. And the king did according to the word of Memucan, for he sent letters unto all the king's provinces, and to every province according to the writing thereof, and to every people after their language, that every man should bear rule in his own house, and that it should be published according to the language of every people. That is the end of chapter 1 of Esther. The king, because the queen, says, no, I will not come at your command. The princes are saying, here's what you should do. Write it in the law that Vashti will no longer be present with the king Ahasuerus, and somebody else will take her place. And send it to everybody in the kingdom. Okay. Well, Vashti will no longer be queen. Okay. No longer will Ahasuerus have Vashti as a wife. Okay. All this to say, how does this really apply to us? God uses imperfect people with imperfect motives in imperfect circumstances to bring about his providential, perfect plan. Because of what happened here, Esther will be chosen as queen. Fast forward. She is going to be, in one sense, the savior of her people, rescuing them from death from the hand of Haman. And you just see God just working in the midst of a pagan group of people all the way through the tale of Esther, even though God's name is never, ever mentioned in the entire book. But God is providentially working. And that's for us today. How so? God is providentially working in our lives to bring about his perfect, providential, perfect plan. Why? Because we have a circle around us. People that we are going to meet. People that we're going to have interaction with. And we can be the lights of God in this dark land, so people can learn and see who Christ really is by us. He's working together everything for his good. Now, we know the ultimate plan of the end times, and that's going to be so exciting. And pre-trib, hey, we're out. If everybody gets to experience the tribulation as what you believe, that'd be quite interesting. So pre-trib, we're out before everything happens in the tribulation. I believe that. Hold my heart, because I actually had to prove it to myself in order for me to believe it. I thought, you know what? If I'm going to believe it, I need proof. I need biblical answers here. And so I went to look for it. Oh, yeah. Pre-trib. I'm all about it. So we're going to be out, and then God's going to rain his wrath on him, but yet Israel will once again be the people of God, and he's going to providentially move and all these different things, and the Antichrist will come, and all the people of Israel will be targeted like never before. You think about how Hitler killed 6 million Jews. That's nothing compared to what the Antichrist is going to come after. He's going to try to wipe out Israel from the face of the planet, but God's not going to let him do it. And so providentially, he's going to work all these things out, and then at the end, Jesus will return. Set everything right. Take care of the Antichrist. Take care of his prophet. 1,000-year reign. And you and I are going to be there. Ruling and reigning. You ask me, what are we going to do? I have no idea. I'm okay with it, though. I want to be like the lowest of the low. I want to be the guy who's right behind Christ with the train. I don't know. It's just whatever. I don't know. Whatever it is, it's going to be great. Whole much better than what we have right now. And then after the millennial reign, after the white throne judgment, new heaven, new earth. Think about how glorious our earth and heaven are. They're a sight to behold. You get down to the molecules and all these different things that we have no understanding about, all the way to the great universe, the constellations, the stars that are out there. And he's going to recreate the whole thing. How much more glorious it's going to be. It's going to be amazing. We're going to see things that only in the wildest of our dreams will we see or even be able to contemplate. But God is good. He's going to providentially work it all out. We know all that. The thing about it is you might not be aware that God is still working in the small details of our lives. The things that He has us do each day. It might be that we're in pain. It might be we have to go to see the doctor. It might be there might be a tumor somewhere in our body. God's working it all out for our good. Even though it's going to hurt, even though there is pain involved, even though there is sorrow, we look forward to His providential, perfect plan in our own lives come about. And praise the Lord, we can go to Him and praise Him for that. Praise the Lord for His perfect plan for us. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for Your goodness. We praise You for Your perfect plan. Help us as we go about our days to be fully surrendered to Your will in our lives. Help us to go forward as lights in the darkness of this world. Help us with the good deeds that we do to shine the light of Your word upon people that have never heard. And Father, we ask You just to bless each person here as we follow after You. Help us to never take our focus off the fact that You are working everything out for Your own perfect plan. We thank You for that. We look forward to how You are doing it in our own lives. Give us encouragement. Help us to fully rely on You, Father. And may You bring more and more things together for that perfect ultimate plan You have for the world. We thank You for that. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.